Hello, we start with the worsening flood emergency in northern Victoria. The state's record-breaking rains have caused three of its biggest rivers to swell, and they all meet at Echuca, which is about 200 kilometres north of Melbourne. Frantic efforts are now underway to save homes and businesses, while elsewhere across the north of the state, residents are being warned it will take days for floodwaters to recede, hampering clean-up efforts. There are now more than a dozen of emergency flood warnings in place, as rain is expected later this week. We'll begin our coverage in Echuca, where a second wave of devastation looms, and that's where Candice Wyatt joins us from this morning. Candice, thousands of homes are now under threat.
Good morning, Lockie. Yeah, as you just mentioned, Echuca is where three of Victoria's biggest rivers meet. The Goulburn, the Campaspe and, of course, the mighty Murray. Behind me is the Campaspe. You can see just how swollen it is. This levee was put in place yesterday by the Defence Force using sandbags packed by the community. It really was an extraordinary effort. It does look to have dropped overnight, but the concern, of course, is the Murray River, which is that natural border between Victoria and New South Wales. When it peaks, it is expected to reach levels not seen since 1870. That's more than 150 years ago, which is why most of Echuca has been urged to evacuate, because authorities are predicting up to 2,000 properties could be impacted by those floodwaters.
It's a very precarious situation. Candice, can you give us an update as well on other areas? What's the situation in Shepparton and Rochester at the moment?
Shepparton is facing a devastating situation. Most of the town is underwater. Residents there fled and now they're either living in their cars or in tents. Floodwaters have dropped around 15 centimetres overnight, but that is not enough to allow residents back home to assess that damage. So they're in a bit of a watch and wait situation there on the Goulburn. While in Rochester, those floodwaters have receded to reveal an utterly devastating situation. The entire town has basically been wiped out. There's wet carpet everywhere. Every business, every home is damaged. And now Rochester is virtually an island. It has been cut off. Help can't come in, and it wasn't in when it flooded. So they're calling for the Defence Force. They want help, and they want the Premier of Victoria to declare Rochester a natural disaster zone so that they can receive more flood funding. Lockie?
Looking at those pictures, that seems very reasonable. Candice Wyatt in Echuca this morning, thank you so much. And towns along the South Australian stretch of the River Murray are starting to feel the flow-on effects from the rising waters in the eastern states. Operators of the Loxton Holiday Park have been forced to close more than 150 campsites as water inundates the lower section of the facility.
In, as I said, shutting down the powered sites, unpowered sites, preparing the amenities and camp kitchen, etc.
We've got the top section of the park, which is 40 sites we're running up here. So there's still plenty of room for people to come and be up here. It's just not down the bottom.
The river level isn't expected to peak until early next month. And many communities across New South Wales are still under a flood threat. The focus now turning to the south of the state in the Riverina region, my apologies, near the Victorian border. The area could see its second worst floods on record. Seven evacuation orders are in place. East Mathoura residents have been told to evacuate by 10 o'clock this morning, while another concern is Moama, 4 kilometres north of Echuca. The town has been warned to expect major flooding from Thursday. The devastation as well is set to push up prices at our supermarkets, with fruit, veg and potentially milk shortages in the coming days and weeks. The federal government has warned no one yet knows how deep the impact will be felt. A man has died in a house fire in Sydney's west this morning. Our reporter Samara Gardner joins us live from the scene in Blacktown. Samara, another person is in a critical condition.
Lachlan, a very sad scene here in Blacktown this morning. A woman in her 80s has been rushed to Westmead Hospital. She's in a critical condition. Meanwhile, a man in his 60s, believed to be her son, did very sadly die this morning. The blaze broke out just after 5 a.m. We understand that both the mother and son were inside the building. The son was able to get out and then attempted to go back in to save his mother. And that is when he's been overcome. Neighbours and emergency services rushed to help the pair. They were pulled from the building. This is what firefighters had to say just a short time ago.
They're very trying circumstances for all of the neighbours and the fire crews. And again, I just want to recognise the neighbours and the first arriving ambulance crew for their assistance to the first crew in doing their best to save the two people in this. And as I said, unfortunately, one person has died.
Fire investigators are on scene now. They're working to establish the cause of the blaze. This seems to be a very tight-knit community and street. It's really rattled the neighbours here, as you can imagine. So a very sad scene here this morning, Lachlan.
It certainly is. Samara Gardner in Blacktown in Sydney's West. Thank you so much. The former Defence Minister has been accused of coaching the Defence Counsel in Bruce Lehrman's high-profile rape trial. Our reporter, Stel Todorovic, has been following this case and she has the details from the ACT Supreme Court.
It was an explosive day in court yesterday when Senator Linda Reynolds admitted she had been sending text messages to Bruce Lehrman's defence counsel Steve Wybrow, first asking for transcripts of Brittany Higgins' cross-examination and then suggesting he look into text messages between Brittany Higgins and her friend and former Linda Reynolds staffer Nicole Hamer. It was put to Senator Reynolds that she's politically motivated by the outcome of this trial, which she denied. Senator Reynolds was quizzed as to whether Brittany Higgins' job was ever in threat and whether she ever tried to stop her from going to police. She denied all of those propositions. When the former defence minister was asked what she knew and when about Brittany Higgins' alleged rape in her office, Linda Reynolds told the court during her first meeting with Ms Higgins about the security breach on April 1, 2019, she didn't know the full details. And once Brittany Higgins got visibly upset talking about it, she told her to speak to the police instead of her. The Crown putting it to her that 10 days out from an election being called, Senator Reynolds was very politically interested in what was happening in her office after hours, with the senator denying that too. Former Attorney General Michaelia Cash also gave evidence yesterday, telling the court she didn't know about the alleged sexual assault before February 5th last year. Ms Higgins worked for Michaelia Cash from June 2019 to January last year. Ms Higgins has previously told the court that she's had several detailed discussions about the allegation with Senator Cash. Mr Lehrman has pleaded not guilty to one charge of sexual intercourse without consent.
Stel Todorovic with that report. The Prime Minister will host Singapore's leader in Canberra today in a bid to strengthen ties over clean energy. The PM is set to host Lee Hsien Loong in Parliament for the first time since winning the federal election. It will be the seventh leaders' meeting between Australia and Singapore. Climate change action and taking advantage of its economic opportunities will be high on the agenda. The trade ministers of both nations are also expected to sign a green energy agreement. We've heard more from CBS's exclusive interview with convicted sex trafficker Ghislaine Maxwell. In it, she labels Jeffrey Epstein the greatest mistake of her life. The candid talks were recorded in August from a low-security prison in Florida. In June, the 60-year-old was sentenced to 20 years behind bars for sexually abusing, recruiting and trafficking girls for Epstein's sex abuse ring.
Acting was the greatest mistake of my life, and obviously if I could go back today, I would avoid meeting him. And I would say that that would be the greatest mistake I've ever made, and I would make different choices where I would work.
Maxwell went on to complain at great length about prison life being restrictive. She says she's only allowed to leave the small cell she shares with three other inmates for about 1 hour each day. At least two people have been killed and 15 injured after a military jet crashed in southern Russia. It hit an apartment block in the town of Yesk near the Ukrainian border. The Defence Ministry says the plane was a Russian Su-34 fighter bomber. According to Russian state media, it was on a training exercise when one of its engines caught fire, its pilot safely ejecting. In Ukraine, meanwhile, Russian forces are attacking the capital Kyiv with a wave of kamikaze drone strikes. Local police have been seen trying to defend the city by shooting at the aircraft. A At least 8 people have been killed by the strikes. Calls are growing to sanction Iran for supplying the drones to Russia. Tehran, however, denies giving Moscow the aircraft. A former West Australian police officer has been convicted of drugging and sexually assaulting 13 women. Adrian Trevor Moore met his victims on dating apps and preyed on them over a period of 12 years. The 52-year-old recorded the depraved acts, which did include bestiality. A jury has found him guilty on all 87 charges. The judge describing Moore's actions as unprecedented sadism. He'll be sentenced in December. After a month of industrial peace, Sydney's long-running train dispute is ramping back up. The Rail Union has announced from this Thursday it will start turning off ticket machines for the evening peak each weekday. That is between 3 and 7pm. To run indefinitely, the shutdown could cost the state $1 million each day. The New South Wales government is seeking legal advice. The two sides have been unable to agree on a new enterprise bargaining agreement and changes to a new train fleet. King Charles has met with refugee families who have resettled in northeast Scotland. His Majesty met families from Afghanistan, Ukraine and Syria who have all made Aberdeen their home. The city has resettled around 1,000 Ukrainian refugees since the war broke out. Charles listened to their emotional stories about their escapes and the challenges they have now overcome. Over the years, His Majesty has regularly taken time out to draw attention to the struggles of refugees.